Sexuality is born in this moment. It is born with life itself. It is present in babies throughout the sexual experiences which they have right from birth. Freud emphasized that babies express their sexual instincts even while feeding at their mother's breast. Actually, a child's sex education doesn't begin with the asking of questions. It begins much earlier, before he knows how to talk. These questions must not be avoided, but rather met with answers which are in keeping with reality. If the child enjoys a happy home life and there's a good relationship between the parents, this should guarantee the healthy sexual equilibrium so important to the assurance of emotional stability. However, sexuality crosses the rocky phase of puberty into adulthood, remaining always a mystery. No one knows exactly what sex is. To shed some light on this mystery of sex will be one of the purposes of this film. To this end, we will represent various sexual deviations. As a matter of fact, within each one of us are all the instincts which, if carried to excess, form the basis of sexual deviations and perversions. When one of these instincts breaks away from the others and grows stronger until it dominates a person's sexuality, that person has a deviation. The situation can be likened to an orchestra, in which one instrument starts playing a separate tune by itself, disrupting the harmony of the group. Therefore, it is by examining the deviated instincts that we will be better able to learn about normal sexuality, because we will be studying it from the point of view of its excesses, almost like looking at it through a magnifying glass. Puberty is the very important transitional phase between childhood and adolescence. It's marked by the activation of the sexual glands in both male and female. The genital organs reach adult proportions and pubic hair appears. The secondary characteristics of both sexes also undergo changes. In the male, the voice changes, and often there is a rapid development in height and muscular structure. His beard begins to grow. In the female, the pelvis widens, the breasts begin to fill out, body features begin to soften and become supple. Puberty is also characterized in both sexes by important psychological and behavioral changes. The girl is in turn seductive and shy, reserved and wild, lively and depressed. The boy alternates between timidity and aggressiveness, rough sensuality and mystical desires. It's a critical, troubled, bewildering phase. It's the age which brings an awareness of the need to satisfy one's erotic drives. It's the moment in which the urge for masturbation is at its greatest, a particularly delicate moment. Choosing an object freely, a conscious choice, is the crowning point in the sexuality of man, and we find it in adulthood after puberty. But before reaching this phase, of course, one must go through many phases. In babies, the idea of choosing is still mostly confused, uncoordinated. So that in babies, we observe, quite normally, certain practices and behavior patterns that we label autoerotic and infantile masturbation, a phenomena that's perfectly normal in a small baby, 1, 2, 3 years old. Now, what occurs in puberty? In puberty, one experiences difficulties related to childhood, especially when the youth has to grow up in our culture. That it's almost inevitable in the phase of puberty that one passes through a second edition, you might say, of these same autoerotic behavior patterns. Now, it's essential to remember that these phenomena are always caused by something. That is, at puberty, they are the product, the effect of the atmosphere in which the teenager moves. It impedes the youth at this most crucial stage from choosing an object for his sexuality. It is, therefore, a transitory and perfectly normal phase of sexual development, And it is nothing short of incredible that for centuries these phenomena of autoeroticism and masturbation were made the object of so much condemnation, and that those practicing them were threatened and persecuted. It's also normal that prior to developing the maturity, he will need to choose an object for his sexuality. A youngster who's still in puberty should try to satisfy his or her sexual needs by masturbation. This is no cause for alarm, and certainly parents must never react by threatening the child who indulges in these practices. Normally, they do not result in anything harmful. Any function of the human body can be pushed to a dangerous excess. This is the only thing that parents should be worried about. So it's a question of leaving the adolescent to follow the normal course of his development. Naturally, and very normally, as he did when he was a baby, he'll end this phase, and finally he will enter full steam ahead into mature sexuality, heterosexuality, the phase in which he chooses his sexual object. Therefore, I would like to recommend to those with children to inform themselves with regard to this age-old problem, and be sure that they treat it with the delicacy and with the prudence, and at the same time with the tolerance and helpfulness that the problem needs. As we have said, masturbation is generally not harmful. However, if carried to excess, it may become one of the primary symptoms of a particular disturbance. This woman is sick. In clinical terms, her illness is defined as nymphomania. A nymphomaniac is a woman in a permanent state of absolutely uncontrollable sexual desire. She is now in the stage which precedes real and true breakup, a stage we shall call preparatory to the abandonment of the senses. It's the worst moment, the most painful for the woman so affected, trying to resist an irresistible impulse, already knowing she will give in to it. Her movements are typical. While she is deluding herself that this will calm her down, she is instead exciting herself even further. Because a nymphomaniac's skin responds to any stimulation in a much stronger way than a normal person's. Nymphomania is not a sexual deviation in the true sense of the term, and has therefore been represented in this film before the true sexual deviations. Nymphomania is a sickness. There is nothing abnormal about the nymphomaniac's choice of sexual object, nor can the sexual act which she desires be considered anything but a natural biological function. Her problem is one of excess, of a perfectly normal act carried to an abnormal extreme. But it's a dangerous excess that often leads the woman so affected to schizophrenia or even death. Sexual deviation, what is it? I suppose it's possible to call it a return to or a fixation on certain moments experienced in the sexuality of pre-adulthood or the sexuality of infancy. For example, while it's perfectly well and normal that a baby at a certain age displays an intense curiosity about things which in some basic or abstract ways are connected with sex, it's clear that when this curiosity prevents the normal sex life of an adult and is the one and only manifestation of his sexuality, beginning at some period subsequent to puberty, this would constitute a deviation which in medical nomenclature is voyeurism or scopophilia. And also exposure, the desire of exhibition, if it's an end in itself, constitutes a deviation, and also an excess of aggressiveness, excessive cruelty, either inflicted as an agent or whenever they're inflicted on someone. We're talking about the deviations of sadism or masochism. In abnormal sexuality, we classify all the deviations in accordance with the nature, of course, of the individual's instincts. For example, an instinct that's normal will propel an individual of one sex towards an individual of the other sex. If instead we should suppose that the individual is propelled to his own sex, we're talking about sexual deviation, in medical nomenclature, homosexuality. And also, say it happens that the object is a person who's still at a very young age. That problem is another type of deviation. We find cases where the object is an animal or even a woman's mannequin or even a corpse, necrophilia. It's evident that within each of these abnormal choices are revealed characteristics belonging to the abnormality of the individual's sexuality. Now then, in this picture we propose to document more thoroughly, with a sensible approach one by one, the various deviations we've discussed. A typical example of a normal instinct, present in all of us, which if carried to excess becomes a perversion, is offered by this bikini-clad beauty. Who doesn't enjoy looking at this girl? Are we perverts because we stop to gaze at her? Certainly not. When a beautiful woman passes, all men turn to look at her, on the street, as she gets out of a car, in nightclubs, just everywhere. The mere fact that a man's eyes are quick to focus on a beautiful woman does not classify him as abnormal, nor does he deserve to be clinically defined as a voyeur. A voyeur, voyeurism, who is a voyeur? And what are the implications of a term like voyeurism? Well, voyeurism is the aberration of the sexual instinct, wherein the individual's only satisfaction comes from watching the sexual activity or genital organs of others. Is the inevitable result of the secrecy with which a culture hostile to sex has for centuries surrounded it. This desire is present in infants as an instinct or partial impulse, but is relegated to a secondary position during the course of sexual maturity and acts as a prelude or accompaniment to adult sexual love. However, in the case of the voyeur, the individual's libido has been twisted so that he seeks pleasure and release only in watching sexual acts and the female body, and is often unable to participate in coitus. As is the case with all other deviations, at the root of are factors of environment and upbringing, especially the individual experiences which reinforce the voyeuristic urge.
Now, it's very late. Time to tuck you in.
Mommy, won't you please stay with me?
No. Now you must go to sleep. You don't want to begin that old story.
Where's Papa?
Your father already came in to say goodnight.
From this moment onwards, this boy is potentially a voyeur. In contrast to the desire to watch is the desire to be watched. One often talks about exhibitionism without knowing the exact distance that separates an act of normal exhibitionism from the pathological level. In fact, here we have some famous people at the center of attention. Their behavior might be defined as public social exhibitionism. But such terminology is better left to the picturesque phraseology of the jet set, since from a clinical point of view, these VIPs aren't exhibitionists at all. In fact, there are a lot of women who'd like to be in their position without any danger of being labeled exhibitionists because of it. When does exhibitionism become a deviation? When can the exhibitionist instinct be said to control the libido? As far as clothing is concerned, exhibitionism is accepted in certain forms which cannot be described as pathological. In fact, extragenital exhibitionism, which is the displaying of various parts of the body, is much more frequent and accepted in women than in men, and is encouraged by the infinite variety of feminine apparel. Feminine exhibitionism is never genital. It may include legs, breasts, hips, waist, hair, but never the genital organs. There are, as we have said, abnormal manifestations and byproducts of masculine exhibitionism. The most common one, considered as a sexual deviation, is the exposure of the penis to women or little girls.
Find enclosed the dossier on your client, Eugene Holbrook, which will enable you to...
It's the right tape, Florian. Transcribe it in two copies, one to be sent to Charles Clement, the other for the archives.
Certainly, sir.
And make me a copy of this brief. It's very urgent.
Yes, sir. Oh, Mr. Fairfax called to confirm his appointment.
Right, tomorrow morning. Florian.
Yes?
You can take the rest of the day off.
Thank you. Oh, will you take care of the plane ticket?
What plane ticket? Yes, I will. Don't worry, Florian.
See you tomorrow, sir.
Gentlemen, the turnover in your company, after merger with the two English firms, has undergone a considerable increase, particularly in the area of textiles. An increase from the 5.2%...
This man is Lawrence Renault, attorney at law, a widely known and highly respected pillar of society. Financially stable, morally unimpeachable, Renault seems to personify the ideals of upper middle class success. And yet, behind this perfectly composed exterior lurks suffering, temptation.
Trends in investments of this class. Naturally, the new programs of the group, which we believe contains the majority of the shareholders, reflect a rapid development of investments of the same order and proportions, which they have submitted to us on an international scale. In the area of chemicals, with the construction of new facilities and the renovation of old installations, which had previously been established only within the metropolitan...
Every day, Renard goes through this obsessive ritual with the same calculated precision. And every day he falls victim to the sickness which makes him a slave to his morbid and unbridled imagination. The name for Renard's illness has a strangely evocative quality about it. Fetishism. Fetishism, of which we see here a few artistic representations, is the concentration of erotic interest on an inanimate object or on some part of the body other than the genital organs. Generally, fetishistic tendencies originate from conditioned emotional reactions, infantile experiences, and frustrated desires. And the object chosen as a fetish is a substitute for fantasies about various parts of the female body, although the fetishist himself is usually unaware of the connection. Like all other psychosexual disturbances, fetishism has its roots in infancy. The infant's only contact is with partial objects. For example, his mother's breast, the thumb he sucks, one of his toys to which he is attracted, and for which he develops an attachment that can seem almost morbid. Only with time does he learn to know and love things and situations in their entirety. An early sexual emotion caused by the vision of or contact with a particular part of the body, breasts, feet, hair, etc., or an article of clothing or a piece of jewelry may help to explain fetishism or the reason for the choice of a particular object as a fetish. Freud discovered that the fetish often serves as a symbol and that what the fetishist is unconsciously searching for is something much more fundamental.
What have you done about our theater tickets for tomorrow?
Oh, my secretary's getting them.
My birthday's only a few days away. You'll remember, won't you?
Of course, dear.
What are you going to give me?
That's a surprise. Same as usual, huh?
Everything in the room was twisting out of shape. That reality was my enemy. That there were strange, terrible things hidden in the shadows. Specters. Ghosts of my infancy. The fear was worse than the pain. Finally, I got used to the pain. Unconsciously, I even began to look forward to it. It got so I wanted them to hit me. The pleasure of suffering got stronger, stronger. Thank you. I even looked for it in the games we played. I enjoyed playing the part of the victim.
Now, you filthy traitor, we're gonna make you sorry, see?
I remember the pleasure I got out of going through those old books about the men and women in the Middle Ages who were so brutally tortured, burned, and beaten. From that moment, the idea of suffering became a delectable fantasy to me, especially if it were inflicted by a beautiful woman, since for me, poetry and evil have always been woman.
Masochism is the bringing of pain and humiliation on oneself in order to satisfy sexual drives. A masochistic temperament is almost always the product of factors in the individual's environment which make it possible and indeed necessary for him to receive pleasure from torture and suffering. The roots of this perversion can often be traced to a family upbringing which regarded natural drives as loathsome and punished the child for any display of them. A masochistic tendency can be intensified by corporal punishment, which stimulates the erogenous zones, especially if inflicted by the parent of the opposite sex. A similar effect can be provoked by frequent instances of unjust punishment or watching the punishment of others. Sadism, on a psychological level, is a monstrous refinement of violence and consists of seeking pleasure by torturing, persecuting, and ravishing one's partner. The problem of sadism can rightfully be understood only when viewed in relationship to the more general problem of the violence which characterizes the social structure of the world today.
No! No, I swear it's not true!
You still want to lie, huh? Get your head in the place!
Think about her!
Let her have a look. It's time she learned what kind of a woman you are!
Let me go! Haven't you done enough to me already? Look!
You know what I want.
Yeah. What about the money?
I'll pay you.
How many times has this girl inflicted on her partner, paid for his part in this atrocious ritual, those same wounds which as a child she saw inflicted on her mother? The shock suffered in infancy has condemned this girl to equate the sexual act with violence. In contrast to the extreme social and professional mobility which characterizes industrially advanced nations, is a rigid concept of the role which the individual is obliged to follow in the social professional sphere to which he belongs. While on the one hand this situation is conducive to the growth of highly efficient and integrated societies, it also encourages individual rebellions or even mass revolution. Among the examples of group defiance against the structure of modern industrial society is the recent behavior of the new generation in the Western nations. In certain cases, youth has answered the obligations and demands that society makes of them with indifference and apathy. In other cases, the rebellion has been affected by the use of drugs. Drugs, a total rebellion against everyone and everything. The hallucinogenics are the last desperate hope of withdrawing from a hostile reality, of escaping the tentacles of technology and mass consumption. Only drugs, declared certain young people, allow us to trip out into the depth of the night to find the lost sun. By the use of drugs, youth may be losing its last battle against the anguish and loneliness of the modern world. Causes of homosexuality, whether masculine or feminine, have been the subject of many theories during the course of medical research, but the leading thesis is that one is driven to homosexuality by what are principally psychological urges. The factors associated with heredity can contribute on a certain level to the explanation of tendencies towards homosexuality in the male or the female. But what they haven't been able to explain is the fact, known to all, of a disposition towards homosexuality in persons of both sexes who, from the point of view of anatomy, physiology, and hormones, don't present any outstanding variations with respect to the normal type of male or female. It's important to bear in mind that nobody can be considered 100% masculine or feminine, not only from the point of view of psychology, but also as far as anatomy and physiology are concerned. Furthermore, psychoanalysis has taught us that many emotions and conscious behavior patterns are in reality defense mechanisms.
I followed a beautiful bird inside an old castle. It was full of spider's webs. No people, just huge insects. A horrible black widow ate the others. I ran down to the cellar and closed the door. The black widow broke the door down. I was so scared. I couldn't look. I fell into a big spider's web. I struggled, but I couldn't break loose. I couldn't escape. And then this spider.
The circumstances that brought this girl, Anne X, to homosexuality were extremely complex. She now lives with a friend, Margaret, with whom she has an unhealthy relationship conditioned by the difference in their temperaments. Each plays a different role. Anne, the weak one, is the daughter. Margaret, shrewd and dominating, plays the mother. Anne feels secure and protected by Margaret. In her imagination, her friend becomes a loving mother, the kind of mother Anne always dreamed about, but never had during her infancy. And so the two girls pamper each other, play and indulge their fancies in whimsical games like this one with the hair pieces, the synthetic curls, the many different colors.
It's too dull.
I prefer this one.
What you're doing. Now take care of your sister and don't drop the milk.
During the formative years of Anne's growth, there was no father figure in the house. Her mother was harsh with her, and in a relationship with her little sister, Anne began to feel like a mother herself, the kind of mother she wished she had. Tender, affectionate, maybe a little rough when necessary. In a word, more or less the way this mother loved and raised her own puppies. As she grew up, Anne unconsciously searched for someone who would play with her the role she had played with her little sister. A woman who would be very interested in her, physically. Maybe playing a bit rough with her at times, but ultimately giving more pleasure than pain, making eroticism triumph over violence. She found that combination in Margaret, whose caresses were now and then spiced with little make-believe torments. The man, then as always, was absent. Anne is dirty and neglected. She cries desperately, but her mother pays no attention. Only with the appearance of her aunt does Anne receive the first maternal care and affection. From this moment, the image of her aunt begins to replace that of her mother in Anne's subconscious. Anne's mind keeps shifting back and forth from the past to the present, from the reality of the moment to the disturbing memories of infancy. The picture of Margaret kneeling on the deck of the boat, running a moist finger along her back, is for Anne a maternal image, full of tenderness. The seawater stirs in Anne's mind the memories of her aunt's caresses, and her first instinctive reaction to stop and hold that hand on her skin in a token of possession and love. And this, unconsciously, was Anne's first homosexual act.
I saw a flower with four petals all brown and blue and yellow. I pulled one off and it broke into little slivers of white chalk. I suddenly felt like a fool because I believed it was real.
Name?
Robert.
Age?
23.
Marital status?
Single.
Sex? Your sex? Your sex? Up to a year ago, female. Today, indefinite. But before long, he will be a man. Robert X really exists. His name was Roberta.
His first real clothes were little girls' dresses. His first toys were dolls. At birth, his genital organs were so malformed as to result in his being declared a girl. His unformed conscious will had no choice but to accept the imposed femininity. Under the psychic pressure, his body underwent glandular changes, producing hormones which actually caused a feminine development of the breasts. It was only later, with the emergence of decidedly masculine physical characteristics, that a conflict began. He had to undergo a long and painful process of readjustment, which included the complete destruction of the acquired feminine personality and its replacement by a newly constructed masculine one. Physically, his transformation was affected by a series of surgical operations. The last one was the one we are about to watch. The case of Robert X has been for the camera a truly extraordinary event. In this, the last of a series of operations, 10 to be exact, which included the removal of the breasts and later the discovery of a sexual organ hidden by malformation, we can say that a woman is becoming a man. In reality, it was from the very beginning a case of a man mistakenly declared a woman by virtue of external malformations, which, when corrected, enabled him to assume his true identity. This operation is for the reconstruction of the urinary canal and the surrounding urethral cavities. Afterwards, plastic surgery was performed on the surrounding skin to reconstruct the sexual organ.
In addition to the sexual deviations, which are provoked largely by disturbances of the mind, there is one other important cause which I would say consists mainly of the malformation of the external genitals. This malformation can be surgically corrected during the period of infancy. Here we see a case of an infant girl with a lipoma of the greater labia of the vulva, which, if not removed at an early stage, can provoke a psychic trauma. Another significant trauma can be produced in the male by the enlargement of the mammaries. It has, in fact, been known to happen in puberty that a boy develops a chest with a woman's proportions. On our right, we see a case of monolateral mammary hypertrophy, and here a case of bilateral mammary hypertrophy. Early surgical attention to these problems has restored the psychological equilibrium of these two adolescents. One of the more important and characteristic situations that may be the cause of errors in determining the sex of a child is the result of a particular malformation within the male genital and urinary system, which in the man uses one external organ, while in the woman these organs are separate. During the development of the urinary tract, in the female, the duct that serves to bring the urine to the exterior is extremely short, while in the male, this duct grows longer and larger, assuming, subsequent to puberty, the additional function of sexuality. But every now and then, it happens that in the male, the urinary duct does not develop completely and is also extremely short, so that the child may be declared a female, while in reality, it's a male. Here are typical cases in which the malformation known as hypospadia was the cause of errors in determining sex at birth. These individuals, raised as females, acquired personalities that were typically feminine, and at puberty they developed breasts. Now, when testicles are present and not retained in the abdominal cavity, it is quite likely that they can be mistaken for an inguinal hernia.
The surgical correction of such a malformation is not as simple as one supposes, or as the newspapers would say. This Iranian tapestry of the 13th century shows a surgeon performing an operation. Of course, we don't know what the result may have been. These days, these operations are usually successful. They may ultimately bring about a change in the baby's registered sex, while in fact the true sex had been in existence all along and was hidden by the malformation of the genitals. Whenever there is a problem in determining the real sex of an infant, the child's parents should at once seek the advice of a surgeon. And if there is still a reasonable doubt that only biological research will be able to eliminate, it's better to declare the baby a male, because the false females are more frequent than the false males. The timely intervention of a surgeon will serve to safeguard the baby from grave psychological repercussions and eventual sexual deviations which, once they are established, will be extremely difficult to correct.
Today, science does not stop at the study of sexual deviations, whether from a mental or a physical point of view. It delves deeply into the whole question of the neurophysiology of sexual relations and its connection with many other aspects of human life. To carry out an act which is born with and part of life itself. An act which is performed countless times every day by billions of human beings throughout the world. Although at the very base of life, although tried by almost all living beings, the sex act has always remained the great unknown. It's only in the last few years, through the initiative of a few scientists, that this act has come to be analyzed under laboratory conditions, with the object of determining precisely the physical and psychic reactions it produces. Hundreds of volunteers submitted to these experiments over a period of several years, during the course of which thousands of completed sexual acts were studied. Exact knowledge of these phenomena will make it possible for medicine to treat more effectively the various disturbances connected with sexual activity. Now, for the first time, and only after overcoming a great many obstacles,
The motion picture camera has finally succeeded in filming this experiment. Undoubtedly one of the most sensational of our time. The extreme delicacy and importance of such an event has always barred it from the screen, until today.
Stand by to begin experiment, thank you. Start with the instrument pre-check. You may lie down now.
All the equipment is turned on.
Go ahead with the pre-check, please.
Electrocardiograph. Man okay? Woman okay? All set here. All right. Pressure indicators. Man's okay. Woman's also okay. Temperature gauges. The man's okay. Woman's okay. The encephalograph of the man is okay. The woman's is okay too. We're set.
I'll take it. You may begin the experiment. All equipment is running. Go ahead. Any stimulation indications yet?
Initial phase is beginning right now. There.
Begin instrument readings.
Systolic pressure. Woman, 110. For the man, 120. The woman has a diastolic pressure of 70. The woman is 85. The man, just over 95. Perspiration barely apparent. Muscular tone, it's beginning to increase in both man and woman. In the man, it's slightly changed and arrhythmical. His rate at this point is 25 breaths per minute. The woman's respiratory rate is also altered and arrhythmical, 27 breaths per minute. Cutaneous reddening, now, the man, barely apparent. The woman? We got a sudden appearance. I have a check now on the set of mammaries. 1 second, please. There's a considerable swelling on the nipples of the woman and a less prominent swelling on the nipples of the man. The present encephalographic reading for both man and woman is normal. The man's pulse rate is up to 135. It corresponds to an increase in his systolic pressure, 135. Diastolic pressure is a bit over 96.
Well, the man is just entering the last phase, the plateau stage. Are we there yet with the woman?
Not yet. The woman's levels are still at the preceding stage.
We'll finish his readings first, then we'll go on with the woman's.
Just now, the man's cutaneous reddening abruptly became more pronounced. The swelling of his nipples is slightly augmented. There hasn't been any increase in perspiration. Now, muscular tone. It's tensed with a spasmodic and rhythmic contraction of the muscular system. She's there. The last phase, the plateau, just starting now.
Give me the data on her now.
All right. Systolic pressure, 150. Diastolic pressure, 110.
She seems to be accelerating.
Encephalogram increase in size and number of spikes.
This should be it for her.
Her orgasm starting right now. Respiratory rate, 35. Heartbeat, 170. Systolic pressure, 175. Considerable perspiration. Muscular tone, loss of self-control. Cutaneous reddening, maximum. Systolic pressure, 160. Respiratory rate, 37. Muscular tone, loss of control.
He's at orgasm.
Sexual education, infancy. Two parallel terms that have been used many times during this film. Two terms which conceal vices and virtues, splendor and misery. In the faces of these children is a warning to society. The disturbing message that society is imperfect, that it is sick, that the parents don't know how to defend their own children. Defending them from danger doesn't mean hiding it or pretending it's not there. It means facing the danger and making the children aware of it. They must be told everything about the most delicate subjects in order to avoid the consequences of some possible future act of immaturity. A sex education that's free from prejudice, prudery, traditional taboos, and obtuse moralism can, in many cases, avoid traumas and irreparable shock during infancy. It can, wrote Freud, lessen the wounds of innocence. It is, therefore, the parent's responsibility to see to it that the ignorance, which is a natural consequence of youth, does not become a primary cause of sickness and unhappiness. It is by fighting this ignorance that we will make it possible for our children to evaluate their lives on a satisfactory, mature level. A young couple, just an ordinary young couple. And yet, these few frames may bring back to us the basic problem of our society. The realization of being far, too far away from the spontaneity and the emotions of these two. It is certainly difficult for us to understand, or even more, to accept the true nature of our reaction. But it is equally difficult to deny that deep within us, there is a definite feeling of envy, a hidden nostalgia for things we lost a long, long time ago, things we have almost no hope of recovering, ever. A young couple, an ordinary, everyday sight. And yet in their banality, these images are ever more rare, more precious. They proclaim the freshness of simple things, the poetry of youth, the beauty of the first kiss. They proclaim the hope that the neuroses, the sexual delirium is all but a moment, a short, obligatory stage in the arc of the evolution of modern man.